in this class, we will delve deep into FBA and get a more practical understanding of what happens when you perform a flux balance analysis. And we look at the concept of gaps, dead end metabolites, and what are known as blocked reactions. Welcome back. So, let's spend some time understanding FBA a little more. I think we've understood flux analysis through some lab sessions and some basic methods including FBA, MoMA, Room and so on. But let's just revisit some of these concepts to fixate them better. There are a few points that deserve special mention. First thing is about reconstruction, right? We did use an E. coli core model, you know, in an earlier class and so on. And there are other models as well. So, so typically a model is written like this, or this is like a small nomenclature. This is the number of genes, this is the, these are the initials of the first author of the paper that is involved. So, this is Adam Fees, this is Jennifer Roth, and this is Nima Jamshidi, and this just says that it is an in silico model. So, this is the nomenclature that is normally used. So, this means there are 1366 genes in this model. It does not talk about reactions or metabolites or any of those, right. And a very nice database that has most of these is called BIG. So, you can, I think, access this from big.ucst.edu. So, there is one important aspect, which is, are these consistent, like interoperable and so on? How are the constraints mentioned? How are the metabolites referred to? One very important aspect is that you need to have, you know, sensible, identifiable identifiers for everything, right. Suppose I say see 00022, right. You just Google for this, or you just look this up, you will find that this stands for pyruvate in the K ligand database, right. But this is important, right. So, you need to have some interoperable names, right. There is also another good database or reconstruction resource called Model Seed, which will use a bunch of nomenclature. There is no problem with using multiple nomenclatures, but the thing is, there should, they should all link back to some universal standard like KB or PubChem or KEG and so on. So, the reconstructions have to be interpretable in some sense. This is particularly important if you want to look at more complex models or community models where you want to integrate two organisms, make them talk to one another and things like that. You cannot have GLC standing for glucose in one and GLU standing for glucose in the other and so on. This sounds like a really minor issue, but this becomes a big deal breaker when you are trying to merge models or study something across models or do anything on a large scale. So, there are some other issues that are intimately related with reconstruction. Let us see what they are. The first is the biomass objective function. So, how do you decide the biomass objective function, or how do you decide the objective function in the first place? We did talk about a few ideas yesterday, but there are several papers that have discussed how the optimality changes or how the predictions change based on the objective function and so on. So, the choice of objective function becomes super critical when we are talking about FBA, right. So, FBA relies on that objective function to pick one flux distribution in the end. So, this is quite important, and usually this happens by sort of estimating the fractional composition of various things, what are the carbohydrates, what are the amount of glucose in the cell mass and so on, right. So, we did see a longish reaction earlier in an earlier class, where we saw that we have x moles of ATP plus y moles of erythrose 4-phosphate plus something plus something plus something giving something else. So, it is a fictitious reaction that is set up to basically capture growth. And to recap, this could be your biomass equation. This means that you need to have ABC in this ratio right. This is not the same as maximizing VA plus VB plus VC plus VW or even alpha VA plus beta VB plus so on. This will attach some more importances to individual fluxes, but you can still have one of these as 0 and still have the same function value, but this sort of represents a non-biologically viable state, right. If I do not have like B, I cannot produce biomass actually.
Why can't we multiply it and see the maximum? Why can't we multiply it and see the maximum?
I did not understand. What do you mean multiply?
That
is a nonlinear function, why would you want to do that? You can have a simple linear function. And the next very interesting aspect of flux balance models is there are dead end metabolites. There are two kinds of dead end metabolites. There are two things you need to understand. You need to worry about gaps and blocked reactions. Gaps, dead end metabolites and blocked reactions. So, gaps are easy to imagine. Let us say you have a cell. Right. And you have metabolic network of this sort. This could be a gap. You know that A goes to B, B goes to C, C goes to D. And then you know that F goes to G, but you do not know how this happens. This has major consequences. The first thing is, do you put it in the model or you do not, right? Because I know that reaction is there, I am inclined to put it into the model, but it is not going to help by FBA cause. Why? Because D would be a, D and F would be what we call dead ends. So, these are metabolites that are only produced but not consumed, or only consumed and not produced. Meaning, how will they occur in the stoichiometric matrix? There will be only one element in that, row, the row corresponding to that matrix. Well, it could have more than one element too, but all of the same sign. What is the problem if all the coefficients are of the same sign? When you multiply that with the vector, you are just going to basically say that V1 plus V2 plus V3 equals 0. And if all of these are potentially irreversible, meaning they can only be in the positive direction, then each of these are 0 independently, which makes them a blocked reaction. So, blocked reactions are those that cannot carry a flux in either direction under a given condition. You can also talk about unconditionally blocked reactions. They cannot carry flux under any condition. Can you appreciate the difference between the two? Conditionally blocked and like totally blocked. So, conditionally blocked reactions cannot carry, the blocked reactions cannot carry a flux in any direction, right. And there are conditionally blocked reactions that may not carry flux under some conditions, but there are other reactions that will not carry a flux under any condition. What could be the difference between the two? It could be environment specific. So when you turn off glucose, some glucose based reactions may not carry flux, they will be blocked. In a fructose or an acetate environment, some glucose reactions will be blocked. Whereas, you know, in a fructose or acetate environment, those reactions may come back alive. Whereas there will be some reactions, potentially like your gaps and so on, they're just going to be blocked. If I then had some H giving I and maybe even some other pathway from D to H, this F giving G is going to be forever blocked. And because I have no idea how to produce F, I have no idea how to use G as far as my network is concerned. Yeah, so gap is when you don't know the intervening biochemistry. I do not know how D becomes F.
And so D and F are dead end metabolites.
Potentially. Okay. I mean, if there was another way to produce F, there could be a problematic gap and a non-problematic gap, so to speak, right? So if you have some A to D and I said F to G is my gap. As long as I have another set of reactions for D and another set of reactions producing F, they won't be blocked, but this might still be a gap. This might be an alternate pathway which has not yet been uncovered. So these become practical issues when you start modeling. So the first thing you want to do with a given metabolic model is open it up and see how many reactions are blocked. Are there any dead end metabolites? And the key reason why these dead end metabolites arise is that FBA does not admit any accumulation. Right? I mean, all you have to do is just keep producing this and have D accumulate. But no accumulation can happen under steady state conditions. Right? So therefore, it's basically a consequence of this identity, this equation. Right? If you have V1 plus V2 plus V3 is 0. You have this issue, they will all have to go to 0. How would you fix this? What is a simple way to fix this? If you have an equation like this which is giving you trouble, a simple way to fix it would be to add minus V4, meaning what does it mean? This is mathematically, what does it mean model wise? Some exchange flux, right? You just now, you have this D giving you trouble. Take D out. You have F giving you trouble, give some F. This should take care of it. So these are sources and sink reactions, sink and demand reactions.
So you know that there is a path between D and F, but we don't know how it occurs. Is it like that?
Yeah. So if you had a scenario like this, where D was anyway going through some other fate later on, and F is already being produced, you wouldn't even be worried about whether I can make D from F. There could be several such reactions, yeah. Right? But in a case where it looks like this, and you're never going to know what is D and what is F, right? I'm writing A B C D F, so you're thinking there's an E in between, right? But there are some chemically related metabolites which seem to not have a connection, and you think there may be a connection. This is very interesting. So there's a lot of recent research about underground metabolism and so on. So this is underground metabolism. This exists, but you are not seeing it yet. So you now understand the concept of a gap, a blocked reaction and dead end metabolites, and also how to put a band-aid fix for dead end metabolites. So I hope in this video you got a good overview of what are the different types of gaps that can exist in metabolic networks. So either the knowledge gaps or, you know, potential model mistakes and so on, as well as the concept of dead end metabolites and blocked reactions. In the next video, we will look at some more concepts related to troubleshooting FBA, wherein we will also look at the ATP maintenance flux and this very interesting concept known as flux variability analysis.